And in Renaissance medicine, Andrea Vesalius, that is Fabrica, his great detailed anatomical atlas, the Human Corporis Fabrica. And we also have not just these sparks, but we have the invention of printing. Indeed, leaving aside the role of China, which was an almost separate world from the West and the Mediterranean all the way to India, we have the printing press was invented in 1456, we say, and Gutenberg invents movable type and copies became cheaper, spread over large print runs. Copies were identical. There were no transcription errors. And this is Gutenberg's movable type, the printing press that we know. It was actually, if you think about it, a precursor to and arguably marked the true beginnings of the Industrial Revolution for the mass production of standardized commodities, in this case books, was made possible by the invention of the printing press. And that was the beginning of another big battle, which is subject of other discussions, between who's the creator, who's the proprietor, and who's the user of the material that is being printed, and who has a say on what gets printed and who pays for it. So in many parts of the world, especially the Anglo-Saxon world, the question was who are the proprietors, not the creators. And so as owner of the equipment, the printer quickly became the proprietor of the creator's work, which was paid only a simple sum at the beginning, and that was the upfront payment. And capital and technical expertise rather than creativity ruled for a long time on what books would be printed and what the terms of trade would be. But the whole issue of copyrights, paywalls, other aspects deserves a separate discussion. What happened at that period, right after the invention of printing, was the emergence of learned societies, what we call the modern learned societies, and their scientific journals. So learned societies emerged in the early 17th century. The first of these was the Accademia di Lincei, established in 1603, which included the most distinguished scientists of the time, including Galileo. Even though he was forced to recant 30 years later, he almost lost his life for defending the Copernican viewpoint. It was a gathering of the great intellects of the time and would continue to be so. And elsewhere, we would see a few decades later the emergence of learned societies like the Royal Society with the motto, Nullius in verba, take nobody's word for it. So the torch passes to Europe and the Renaissance. And Italy led the Renaissance with the enormous, magnificent actions of people everywhere. The spark of genius was allowed to transform the world with great art like Michelangelo and Leonardo da Vinci, not just art, but interest in practically everything from the mechanics of man to anatomy. And of course, to the greatest scientist of his age, Galileo Galilei, of communicating science along with books. Newton's Principia is a book, and what a book it is. The most important book that changed the attitude of the world, even though it is a very difficult book to read. But I can say, and I think most people would agree, that before Newton, most people did not believe that there were laws that governed the universe, and that if such laws existed, they were beyond the ken of human beings to discover. After Newton, the prevalent opinion was that there are laws that govern the universe, and what we don't know today, we will discover tomorrow. What a monumental shift created by a book that hardly anybody was able to read. And the journals that emerged from the learned societies became the rapid way in which we find out what is happening, new discoveries were being done. That became the key means of science communication. And the peer review process was to ensure quality and therefore confidence in the published material. And the scientific journals have become the primary means of communication in modern science. In fact, in 1905, Albert Einstein, only 26 years old, publishes his five miraculous papers in the top scientific journal of his day, the Annalen der Physik, in 1905. And that becomes the revolution that would transform our understanding of modern physics. And a decade later, Einstein successfully deals with integrating gravity into what becomes the general theory of relativity. And there was a prediction there that if you could see a star close to the sun, you would realize the rays of light were bent, and they were bent more than would have been predicted. And in fact, Arthur Eddington and colleagues would undertake travels in 1919 to places where Guyana and West Africa, where they could actually see a total eclipse, and they proved that the predictions of Einstein were correct. And from there, it went to the general press, and Einstein became a global celebrity when all the press of the world started reporting on that miraculous discovery of the new scientific theories that affected gravity and time and space and matter and energy. But the public press, which grew along with literacy throughout the 18th century, has also played a role against science. So we didn't have the more responsible press that we have today. We also started with a lot of yellow journalism and sensationalism, and it went on. And sometimes the popular press fought against scientists and their journals. Let us call what we call now disinformation, and consider the case of Edward Jenner and vaccination. And look at this cartoon from Punch in 1802, which shows as if the vaccination with the cowpox would produce cows coming out of somebody's mouth, of his nose, of his arm, etc., to warn against the vaccination. But in the end, over the long haul, science always prevailed. And Charles Darwin and The Origin of Species is a prime example of how, yes, there are still debates here and there, but fundamentally, the theory of evolution has taken root. But that's not the only way that publications were made and reaching people in general. There were also archives, museums, and libraries that were developed and became part of our fundamental existence and communications for scientific publication and otherwise in the 20th century. So let us look at archives. Well, the ancient Egyptian scribes were the archivists of the ancient world. And so said Herodotus, the father of history. And all modern institutions and nations have maintained archives. Some of the old-fashioned archives, still found in some of the poorer developing countries, have now been converted gradually through the digital revolution into what we can recognize as the modern archives in most nations and institutions. Museums have also been great centers of learning and of communication. The great encyclopedic museums of culture like the Louvre or the British Museum, Metropolitan, many other great museums, and also museums of natural history, whether in New York, London, Washington, or elsewhere, they have brought to life evolution, the dinosaurs, and the great creatures of our time, like the blue whale and the titans of the past and the present. The ever-popular exhibits are ways of introducing children to science, which is essential. Some are science museums of technology, like the Air and Space Museum, or sometimes it's just to make learning fun, like the Exploratorium in San Francisco, and interactive exhibits to excite the spirit and engage the mind of young and old alike. And now with virtual reality, holography, interactivity, what will museums become? The world needs to engage in a rich discussion about the role of museums, from the collectors and exhibitors of objects to major institutions of science and learning. Now, of course, I cannot end this survey without coming to libraries. Remember, I am the Emeritus Librarian of Alexandria. To keep our books and journals, we relied on libraries, public libraries, or attached to institutions of learning and research like university libraries. Oxford University has, of course, the magnificent system of historic libraries called the Bodleian Library. The Library of Congress, with its magnificent reading hall, the New York Public Library, one of the largest libraries in the world, and the systematic classification of material, including copies of the science journals that are kept there for reference and review. But then came the digital revolution and the internet, and all the storage systems that existed have now been transformed to computers. And the new Library of Alexandria, for example, was born in the digital age and shows glimpses of the libraries of the future.